Lately, we've seen lots of discussion about race relations in media. It's been sparked by a Florida jury's acquittal of George Zimmerman in the shooting death of black teen Trayvon Martin and a controversial stop and frisk policy in New York City. But some critics question if the discussion has been distorted by a race for ratings. Joining us to debate this and the fairness of the media's race coverage here in Washington, Brian Beutler, political writer for Salon Magazine, and in New York, CNN anchor Don Lemon and New York Times columnist Charles Blow. Now, before we start this discussion, I want to take a look at two different takes on the death, shooting death of Australian baseball player Chris Lane.
Alan West has tweeted this, quote, three black teens shoot white jogger. Who will President of the United States identify with this time? Excellent point. I wonder when celebrities are going to put on I am Chris Lane t-shirts.
Why isn't Al Sharpton protesting this? I protest when I'm called in and when there's an injustice. The three were arrested. There was nothing to protest. The system worked there.
Now, we should point out that Steve Ducey was mistaken, and we later discovered that two of the young people who were accused of this crime were black, and one of them was white. So, Charles, I want to go to you first and ask, you wrote a great column on Friday that talked about a weariness and outright hostility about the continued focus on racial equality that we're seeing in society today. Have media displays like what we just saw contributed to that?
Well, I don't think that it helps, particularly when we're fishing around to try to find some parallel to this, to the Trayvon Martin case. And I don't think that this particular case is the only one that we've seen since the Trayvon Martin case has occurred. And it seems to be some sort of tragedy competition to see, can we figure out a polar opposite case where we can point out the fact that there may be some inconsistencies or some inequality. And I think that what people are suffering from is some sort of selective amnesia on the Trayvon Martin case, because unlike that case, this particular case with the Australian baseball player, we're just a week away from the, a little bit more than a week away from the, when he was killed. It has been all over the news. I have talked about it on television at least twice. There's been newspaper, there's been television, and that was not the case in the Trayvon Martin case. It was a very local thing. It stayed that way forever. And when people started to write about it, Tremaine Lee and the Huffington Post, Ta-Nehisi Coates on his blog, and when I wrote my column about it, none of us were saying, where is Rush Limbaugh? Where is Glenn Beck? Why aren't they demanding justice here? Why aren't they? No, and I think that the media, the mainstream media, is kind of taking the bait here, as if these guys are the paragons of equal justice and of equal treatment. They're not. They've now, never now, been that, and they're demanding that of us.
Charles, I'm sorry. I want to break in real quick and go to Don, because Don, sure. I think you may have faced the other side of this. You did a commentary where you talked about the five things that black folks could do to improve things for themselves, and you got a huge backlash. Is that because race is so tough to talk about in today's media?
It absolutely is, and I think race is the third rail, obviously, that runs through this country. I'm not the first person to say that. But yes, what I said, I talked about five suggestions in helping yourself, because when you want to improve something, the first place you look is within. You look at yourself. What I talked about had nothing to do with ending structural racism and ending institutional racism. Of course, those things need to be dealt with. But until you look within and figure out what you can improve for yourself as a group or as an individual in your own community, when you do that, then you can deal with the structural and institutional racism with a much clearer, educated mind. And yes, it is very tough, Eric, to talk about race honestly in any form, especially on television. And it's not any easier, I have found out recently, if you are African American, if you're coming at it from the perspective of a black person.
Now, Brian, I want to turn to you. You wrote a really moving piece for Salon where you talked about getting shot, almost dying. Two African Americans committed the crime, and yet that didn't change your idea or your commitment to opposing stop and frisk laws. Now, how did the media react to that? And tell me what you learned being at the center of that sort of media firestorm.
Overwhelmingly, the response to the piece was positive. People sent me personal notes, and also thoughts about what I said about how the media should talk about crime, or how the media does treat crime. And in general, I got the sense that media is sort of being reffed. People want reporters, anchors, hosts, et cetera, to try to kind of create this weird tally about, you know, white on black crime versus black on white crime. When in reality, you know, crime is a rare enough thing that it doesn't need to be nationalized in this sort of way, and it doesn't need to be sort of like sort of tete-a-tete, race on race. And I think most reporters, most people in the media understand that, but they feel this pressure from elements, I guess, on both sides, but in this case, from conservatives to sort of treat certain cases as if they offset others.
Well, it's interesting because I've even got people on my Twitter feed saying, you know, so many black people commit these crimes, and so there must be some culture of violence in the black community. How do you push back against that as a journalist, but also sort of stick to the facts?
I've kind of tried to root it in statistics. I mean, there's a discrimination element here, which I think is obvious to a lot of people. But in general, what I said in my piece about what happened to me is that I was extremely unlucky, and that it would be a fallacy for me to treat everyone who resembled my attackers as if they were potential criminals. And that's just a fact. It's not something that I'm inventing to try to establish credibility for myself. It's just true. I cross paths with you know, hundreds of black people in Washington, D.C. every week. None of them have tried to mug me since then or tried to shoot me since then.
Can I jump in here, Eric?
Sure, sure. Come on in, Don.
Listen, we must be honest. And it's not because someone is African-American or Hispanic or a minority that they happen to be violent. But there is, if we're going to be honest about it, a culture of violence in this country. Number one, among young men, when you see all the stories that have happened this week, that's a reflection of what's happening in the country. And yes, there is a culture of violence among African Americans for whatever reason, for racism, for lack of education, for all of those things. But we cannot ignore the fact that in many cities around the country, young men of color are killing each other. I had two mayors on yesterday from Philadelphia and New Orleans, and their first thing is, if someone falls into a hole, you must get them out. And then you figure out how they got in the hole after you get them out. So first, we have to stop the culture of violence among young African-American, and especially young African-American men. There is a crisis in this country.
Now, Charles, I'm going to break in, and I'm going to give you the last word. You got about 10 seconds. What do you think?
Yes, right. But I think when we say, let's be honest about the statistical reality there, which is that the universe of criminals is tiny compared to the overall population. Most people are doing right.
That's right.
Doing the right thing. And when we try to extrapolate the demography of a small group of criminals onto the vast majority of people who are doing what they're supposed to be doing, I think we do ourselves a disservice as a country. And
I'm going to have to break in.
Young African Americans.
I'm going to have to break in. Again, another subject we could talk about forever. Brian Beutler, Charles Blow, Don Lemon, thank you so much for joining us.
It was a pleasure, Eric.